So I would like to welcome Markus Aspelmeier from the University of Vienna, who's going to talk about the title that you can see there. So off you go, Markus. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure. Without further ado, so many things have already been said, so it's really hard to contribute anything new here at the second to last day of the conference. I still try. Okay? So here's my first contribution. We heard a lot about the famous Chapel Hill conference already from 1957. I would like to contribute a little anecdote how the Chapel Hill conference came into life. And here I quote from a letter that John Wheeler wrote back then in order to get funding for the Chapel Hill conference. And this is really a beautiful letter. So he says, "The absence of any paradox or discrepancy in gravitation theory at the human and astronomical levels creates an obligation to apply Einstein's ideas down to smaller and smaller distances. One must check as one goes until one has either a successful extension to the very smallest distances or a definite contradiction or paradox that will demand revision. The challenge cannot be evaded. Exactly how to proceed is a matter of wisdom, skill, judgment, and a good idea. Nobody guarantees to have a good idea, but the De Witts, fortunately, have a very sound plan of what to do while searching for a good idea." And the plan was to organize this conference, which actually happened. And just for completeness, the two experimentally relevant questions that were discussed at that time was, at Chapel Hill, was, do gravitational waves exist? And do we require quantum description of gravity? Again, completing sort of the tour de force of this week of the conference, there are two approaches to probe the quantum nature of gravity. And I explicitly exclude now such experiments that test the influence of Newtonian or general relativistic effects on quantum systems. Okay? I only am interested in the quantum nature of gravity, not in the gravitational reaction on two quantum systems. So the first type of experiments, they assume that there exists a quantum theory of gravity and then probe the low energy consequences. Such type of experiments do not necessarily require gravity measurements because typically you look at the dynamics of quantum systems and the modifications thereof. And so you just need to have very good precision measurements of these quantum systems. The other type of experiments assume nothing and more or less, and so then they essentially directly probe the consequences of quantum configurations of gravitational source masses, and those do require measurements that are sensitive to gravitational interaction. Just for completeness, for those of you who want to follow up on the topic, on the first part, there are several proposals and experiments out there where people are looking into low energy consequences of existing theories of quantum gravity. And it turns out that optomechanical systems are particularly well suited for some of these tests. For example, several of these quantum theories of gravity modify the dynamics in such systems from the generation of geometric phases that can be detected to mechanical unharmonicities due to modified commutator relations, modified ground state energies, and so on. So you find many of those in works by either Igor Pikovsky and Jaroslav Prugner here, and there are other works by Francesco Marin and also Alessio Bilenchia or Martin Plinio. Now, the thing that we are interested in here at the conference mostly is actually looking at quantum systems with gravitational source masses. I do not need to go into details here. This has already been explained. So based on these original discussions right now in the literature, there have been proposed two different types of experiments to generate gravitational entanglement via gravitational interaction. The one is where you start out with two objects in a superposition of center of mass, and you exploit a dynamical gravitational phase like in the Kao experiments to achieve a C-sine gate operation. Sugato has explained it very nicely in his talk to generate entanglement. Or you couple gravitationally two harmonic oscillators, essentially, or let's say two wave packets in free fall, if you want, that become entangled more or less with the same entanglement rate. And the challenge is now to make these rates here larger than the decoherence rate in the system. Now, what I would like to focus on in the few minutes that I have is more or less a reality check. Okay, so where are we with respect to using quantum systems as gravitational source masses, which requires us to address two questions. Question number one, how small can we make a source mass and still probe its gravitational field? So in a way, we need to be able to isolate gravity as interaction and discern it from the other interactions that are present. And how massive can we make a quantum system? Let's start with the first one, how small can we make a source mass? If you look at this plot here that shows current experiments with respect to mass and center of mass displacements, and here's coherence time for such experiments where you have a superposition of the center of mass. And stick briefly to the gravity case first. If you look at the smallest source masses to date for which a gravitational field has been measured in a lab-based experiment, you're down at on the Gram scale. Okay? So there are beautiful experiments by Mitrofanov and by the Edelberger group that have demonstrated gravitational coupling of objects on this order of magnitude. So what we wanted to find out is simply for us, what does it take to make very precise measurements of gravity, and how small can we go? So what are actually the limitations? If you really want to push it to microscopic systems being coupled via gravity, what does it take experimentally to exclude all the other coupling mechanisms, or to at least make them irrelevant for the type of coupling that you want to isolate or observe? So here's the idea. We started out by thinking, well, if you have a small source mass, then obviously you can modulate the source mass with a certain amplitude quite fast in principle, so as a function of time, you have a modulation of the source, and then you have a test mass at whose location the gravitational field is now modulated as a function of time because of the source mass modulation. So the test mass now will experience a time-dependent acceleration modulation, that because of the nonlinearity of the gravitational interaction, not only has a linear component, but also quadratic and higher order components in the response of the test mass to the nonlinear, to the drive of the source in a nonlinear potential. The masses that were involved, at the end of the day, if you look here on the left side, the way we decided to start our experiment is to have the test mass in the form of a torsional balance configuration. We have gold masses connected with a glass rod and a little mirror where they reflect light like an optic lever, and where the deflection here of the test mass results in a rotation that you can then monitor and measure. The source mass is a 90 milligram, 1 millimeter radius gold mass that can be modulated here. It's sitting on a tungsten rod with a motor, and the modulation is on the order of a few millimeters, and of 2 millimeters. And the smallest distance between the two masses is on the order of 400 micrometers. There's a Faraday shield between. And the acceleration modulation that we expect from this configuration is on the order of 10 to the minus 11 g. Now, in the experiment itself, since this is the expected acceleration of the test mass, it was clear that we need to be careful about isolating our system from the environment, because we need to distinguish now accelerations due to gravitational acceleration from other accelerations and other force contributions in the system. Just to give you an example that this is not totally trivial, and we have heard already several comments, and I've seen, of course, Jan's wonderful talk and Jake's comments on what they have to do at NIST to isolate their system. So here's our example. Here's our small test mass oscillator. And what you see here is frequency resolved amplitude data of the oscillator as a function of time. So you have here the different strength of the frequency components. Dark is no response, yellow is large response as a function of time. And you see that each day, basically more or less 24 hours, we you have relatively strong strong modulations on the 10 millihertz regime, on the 10 millihertz scale, and higher orders of that. And this coincides nicely with the traffic light cycle of the road crossing Währinger Straße, Nussdorfer Straße, which is around 60 meters away from our lab. Then what you see here, the dark stripes, this is, of course, when the tram stops to operate during the night and the cars don't go anymore. And these are, of course, very nicely noise-free 6-hour time slots during the day, where the rejection rate of data is quite low. But it's not times 7, it's only times 5, because you see here also there are 2 days a week where it's not pitch dark, but it's more yellowish again. This is because Friday night and Saturday night, people are out on the street celebrating and partying. We also had a look into the Newtonian noise. So I think I told some of you already that, so here's our lab. Here is Währinger Straße, and the purple dots here are the tram stations. And so they are going here, moving along, and each tram of the Vienna city weighs 90 tons, 90. So that means there's a gravitational pull to our experiment of a magnitude that is comparable to the gravitational signal that we expect from the our 1 millimeter gold sphere at a distance of a few hundred micrometers. Now, we basically what Tobias did, he took his mobile phone and he rode the train several times. He did a GPS real-time tracking of the tram traffic, and from that reconstructed a projected Newtonian noise at the location of our experiment. And what you see here is again an amplitude spectrum as a function of frequency, and you can see that around between 10 and 1 millihertz, you see extremely strong contributions. And the magnitude is on the order of the signal that we expect. So if we would not have had a torsional balance, just a regular harmonic oscillator would actually have seen these noise contributions from the Newtonian tram noise in our experiment. Okay, also this slide is just to show you that in order to understand the nature of the coupling, we really tried to nail down each and every possible systematic effect that we know of in our experiment. It was not designed originally to be a precision experiment, but at the end we became ambitious and wanted to know what the ultimate limits of precision are. And so we made the best out of the what was existing, and sort of did a backwards evaluation of all the systematics. Instead of designing the system to minimize systematics, we sort of tried to be as precise as possible in assessing the systematics. Now, and as you can see, we took into account things like the fact that the source mass actually has a hole in it where the titanium rod is inside, leads to obviously a negative gravitational effect. Then there's a positive gravitational effect of the titanium rods, the gravitational effect of the capillary, the glue, and so on. Magnetic effects, electrostatic effects, you name it. Now, at the end of the day, we could nail down the systematics to on the order of 10%. And we knew that the other was gravitational. And so purely gravitational in the sense of Newtonian gravity between the center of masses as we have monitored them. And here's the results now. You see the displacement as a function of frequency. We have nanometer scale displacements in the experiment due to the acceleration modulation. We see a linear response of the test mass. We also see the second order response due to the nonlinearity of the Newtonian potential. Generated by a source mass of 90 milligram. The precision of our experiment is on the order of 10 to the minus 13 G after averaging over 10,000 seconds. And as I said, the systematics is on the order of 10%, so we can determine Newton's constant, and we agree with the co-data value of the coupling to within 10%, where this 10% really is the systematics that we understand fully. Okay, so so much now for the gravitational case. So that means what we have now at the moment in our lab is actually the smallest source mass of which one has measured the gravitational field so far. And the idea is now, of course, to push further now in this direction. So now we are somewhere here. We can exclude down to like a 90 to 100 milligram. And the next step is really want to push another couple of orders of magnitude. We think that it's reasonable that we can measure gravitational acceleration from a Planck mass object, which is a 100 micrometer sized sphere, for example. So this would then give us another push in this direction. So we are coming already, well, not very close, but at least we are approaching this domain for which quantum effects of masses in superposition, spatial superpositions, have already been demonstrated. And I would like to point out I think the two most beautiful experiments at the moment in this regime is actually the meta-wave experiments by Markus Arndt and my colleague at the University of Vienna. Here, the world record, I hope, Markus, it's still a correct one, because he's like breaking records all the time by increasing the masses, is an object with like 25,000 AMU and superposition size that is gigantic, much, much larger than the object itself. And on the other hand, with respect to solid state oscillators, where the mass is much higher, so you see the mass is on the order of 10 to the 13 atoms instead of 10 to the 4. But the superposition size in these experiments by Andrew Cleland, where you have superposition of thickness oscillations, actually it's energy eigenstates of thickness oscillations, is only on the order of sub-femtometer. This seems to be at the moment the dilemma, that you can either have extremely large superposition, but not yet solid state densities and masses, or you can have solid state densities and masses, but not large superposition. So in both of these cases, if you compute the delocalization in the superposition and the product with the mass, it's in both cases in the order of 10 to the minus 29. And as we discussed, if we take into account coherence times, then of course the molecular interference wins out by essentially 9 orders of magnitude. And still the goal for the experiments we're discussing here in probing the quantum nature of gravity would require to scale this number up dramatically. This is why we thought, why not combining the best of two possible worlds, so the solid state, the solid object high density with the free fall benefits of full control long coherence times, by essentially levitating the solid in an external potential that can be controlled and even switched off. Okay, so and I don't go into all the details because many of you already know it. I just show you our recent results. Here, this is an experiment spearheaded by Lorenzo Marini and Constanze Bach. We trap a nanoparticle of around 150 nanometers in diameter. It's a silica particle in the focus of a laser beam. So it's a typical optical tweezer. And we keep it in a vacuum can. We have forward scattered light. So the particle is trapped here. Light is scattered forward and backward. The forward scattered light can be collected. You can collect position information in all three directions of the motion, X, Y, and Z. And you can feed that back into the trap. So basically the intensity of the trap, for example, and via parametric feedback can stabilize the position of the particle. This allows you to remove all the rest gas here and operate this experiment on a level of 10 to the minus 8 to 10 to the minus 9 millibar. The next that you do is now, instead of collecting the information in forward scattering, you collect the information in the Z direction here in backscattering. Backscattering carries the most information. So if you manage to really collect all the light, in principle, you can realize a Heisenberg limited detection. And this you could use for feedback. And this is what we did. So Lorenzo and Constanze established here confocal backplane imaging that allows now really detection at the Heisenberg limit. So we have a room temperature position measurement without an optical cavity that resolves that fulfills the Heisenberg limit up to a factor of 1.7, which means that we can now track the quantum trajectory of the particle in phase space in real time with a precision almost at the level of the zero point motion. This is a 1.3 times the zero point motion. We use Kalman filtering. We collaborate here with the team of the control theory group at the TU Wien of Andreas Kugi. We use Kalman filtering in combination with optimal feedback control to to state estimation, optimal state estimation in the of the quantum trajectory, and optimal feedback by solving in real time an optimality condition to minimize the energy, such that we can cool the particle now in its quantum ground state approximately 0.5 occupation in a room temperature environment just by measurement and feedback. So here's a photo I like very much. This is actually our particle being kept in the quantum ground state in a room temperature environment basically monitored here with a green laser. Now, as you know, you can also do it another way. So ground state cooling can also be achieved by a cavity. That's another experiment we did. I basically want to just briefly highlight it because it combines nicely these different techniques. In that case, you keep the particle in the tweezer, but now you have a cavity. You stabilize the tweezer frequency with respect to the cavity such that the cavity resonantly enhances now the anti-Stokes scattered photons in a Raman scattering process such that the photons that are scattered into the cavity take away the energy and cool the particle into the quantum ground state of motion. These schemes have been suggested in the late 90s already by Helmut Ritsch and independently by Vuletic and Chu, and have been implemented first with atoms, and ground state cooling has first been achieved now with our dielectric particles. A nice thing is that this scheme is completely insensitive to phase noise in compared to all the other cavity cooling schemes. And so we combined now, this was a team effort led by Uroš Stelic, we combined now here the tweezer with the cavity, and by making the anti-Stokes scattered component resonant with the cavity frequency, we could actually demonstrate now ground state cooling of the particle. So this also was similar to our feedback-based ground state cooling. We now have a room temperature environment and we cool the particle two occupations below a half, which means center of mass temperatures on the order of some tens of microkelvin. Now, next steps, needless to say, would be how about now extending to large quantum states, for example, via free fall. This is, would be one of the benefits of a trap, right? Because you can switch it off now, have a free fall of some tens of milliseconds, and have already a wave packet on the order of the particle radius. But this, as has of course been mentioned many times now during the conference, requires low pressures and low temperatures because essentially black body radiation will limit you dramatically in the extent of the superposition that you can achieve. And for our current experimental parameters, you see we could at most expand coherently by a factor of 3. But if we would have parameters like that, then we should be able to expand up to the level of the particles. Now, again, another possibility is to create large superposition states. This you can do either measurement based. There have been a couple of proposals in the literature where you expand the wave packet and then perform essentially a projective measurement by coupling it to a nonlinear system and generate a superposition. Or as we have heard now already many times and will hear also by Gavin, by using an alternative, an internal degree of freedom in the Stern-Gerlach configuration. And these activities of generating a large superposition state is now part of a synergy grant together with Oriol, Lucas, and Rommel. Okay, I'm almost.
It's just 5 minutes. Just
okay, very good. I'm even faster than that, which is rare. Whoa, maybe I should just wait 2 minutes now. I think I never finished before. Okay, so the two remaining things that I wanted to say is one of the necessities for such experiments, would really be cool if you could manipulate the wave packet arbitrarily. Okay, and one way of doing that is essentially to shape the potential landscape that the tweezer provides you with, and this is what we're doing at the moment. The main idea is, of course, that as you know, the intensity profile of the laser beam of the trap beam defines is just the inversion of the potential landscape that the particle sees. So if you manage now to change the spatial profile of the trap beam, you can change also again in real time the potential landscape of the particle. You go from harmonic to, let's say, quartic to a double well to a repulsive potential. All of that is possible. And Mario Campini and Nikolai Kiese's group has been setting up such an experiment at the moment where he overlaps two spatial modes. They are AOM controlled, so you can modify them at an 80 megahertz frequency. They're combined on SLM to generate this superposition here. Using electrodes, you can even tilt the potential for a charged particle. And now we have basically particles sitting in a tilted double well that we can now modify in real time. What we are also doing, because this is the session on short range forces, we also have now two particles in such a double well, and we can measure now the forces between two particles, be it dipole forces, Coulomb forces, and so on. So they are separated only by a few micrometers, and we can very nicely study now the interactions between these two particles. Okay, finally, this is just a sneak preview of preliminary data that is not yet published. This is an effort that has been built up over the years now by this wonderful team. Namely, this is going to larger particles using anti-Helmholtz coil configuration and superconducting objects. So what we have at the moment in the lab is a 100 micrometer superconducting sphere. So it's a thin lead alloy that is levitated at temperatures below 20 millikelvin in a dilution refrigerator between in an anti-Helmholtz coil configuration. The position is read out with a squid. The whole thing is packaged, as you can see here in this chamber. It's hung from little strings again for vibration isolation. And the preliminary data suggests that we have amplitude damping times on the order of 10 to the 4 seconds and dephasing times on the order of 80 seconds. So this is quite a promising start for future experiments. Feedback would be next via the squid, obviously. Okay, so I think I'm at the end. There, needless to say, there's a decoherence challenge in all of that. This has been mentioned in many, many talks already. So if you go for either of these two proposals, the question is how large does the delocalization have to be? The smaller the particle, the larger, obviously, the delocalization. Because of the smallness of the mass, you need to compensate by the delocalization. However, the interesting thing is because of the dependence of the ground state extension with the mass, the actual amount by which you have to delocalize with respect to the ground state essentially stays the same. So no matter whether you operate with a 100 nanometer glass sphere or nanodiamond, or you operate with a Planck mass lead sphere as we have here, or with LIGO mirrors, you will always have to expand your wave packet or delocalize it by on the order of six, like on something like six orders of magnitude compared to the ground state size, and operate at small temperatures. But this has been pointed out already by many. So with this, I conclude. This is what we are doing and are interested in. I think, as many of you have already said, these are fascinating times. These are fascinating directions. We here in Vienna are particularly interested in these two questions: how small can we make a source mass and isolate gravity as a coupling force, and how massive can we, on the other hand, make a quantum system and potentially overlap the two at some point in a bottom-up, top-down approach where those two parameter regimes come together. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you very much, Marcus. Perhaps if people would like to put up their hands to ask questions. But as the chair, I'll ask the first question. So you mentioned you would like to get to something like 2 microns for the, I think, 75 nanometer. You'd like to get a spread of 2 microns. How feasible is that, based on at the moment? I mean, how well can you do in, a year, 5 years?
Yeah. That's definitely exactly the right question to ask. I think we have, so I'm now talking, I take it your question is now, when we talk about squeezing, is really, let's say we have just have a wave packet and want to squeeze the wave packet. Okay, so what, how well can we do? I mean, I'm confident that, using our Kalman filter has quite some advantages. You have an optimal state estimation and filtering plus feedback protocols. I could imagine that via a sufficiently intelligent feedback control, you could generate squeeze states. There is no cavity limit in a sense, okay? So the limit will be decoherence. So, yeah. So certainly I'm confident we will see some squeezing soon. And then, You know, again, inverted potential, coherent inflation of the whole thing. There's so many possibilities. It's really hard to say. I also have to say I'm highly doubtful that such numbers here, like 60 dB, are reasonable. Practical. I think the largest squeezing ever observed is in spin states. No, there's a spin squeezing with about 30 dB at the moment. I think this is the
record.
Yeah, totally ever record.
Okay, well, thank you. So Christian, would you like to ask a question?
Thanks, yes. Thank you, Marcus, for the talk. I want to know, when you have the two particles in the double well and you lower the barrier, they will at some point be in one in a single well. Are you able to separate them again, or are they just lost and stick together?
That depends. Okay, because you know, optical, the scattering of the particle of the two tweezers generates optical forces. So there's optical binding, and for these small particles, essentially dipole-dipole interaction between the two. That can remain repulsive. Okay, so it could have bound states or something like that.
Okay, thank you.
And maybe, Anupam, just a last question before we move on, and we can have further questions later on.
Thanks, Marcus. Wonderful talk, always. So just a curious question. So when you said that you went up to, you could cool it to the ground state, so for how long could you keep this?
That's the point. It's a feedback. It's continuous feedback. It stays in the ground state as long as the feedback is on.
And in the process of the feedback, you also get rid of the rotational degrees of freedom completely. And could you see that when the rotational degrees of freedom also freezes?
No. We do not resolve the rotation. Okay. Good point. Yeah.
Thanks.
This is still on the to-do list.
Yeah, because this could be a very crucial game also.
Yes.
Anyway, we can talk.
Okay, yeah, I think we should leave it there and move on. Thanks very much, Marcus, for the very interesting talk. And I guess there'll be more discussions later on. So shall we move on to Hendrik?